I want to thank you for joining us for this Wednesday evening service as we experience another area of the Word of God and receive our strength that we need to keep us going. I appreciate everybody watching these messages on Facebook from time to time. My daughter told me, though, that I need to tell a joke once in a while, so I guess I'll try that. Here goes. Let me give you four chuckles tonight. A stranger walked in a little country church and sat on the back row. After an hour or so, he started squirming. He leaned over and asked the lady next to him, "How long's he been preaching?" She said, 30 or 40 years, I think." The stranger replied, "Well, I guess I'll stay. Surely he's about through by now." The preacher was asked how many his church would sleep in case of a tornado. The preacher replied, "On Sunday morning, we sleep about 75. Sunday school teacher asked her class, "Why is it necessary to be quiet in church?" Little girl said, "Because people are sleeping." Preacher said, "Miss Brown, your husband walked out of my sermon last Sunday." Miss Brown said, "I know, he walks in his sleep all the time." And so there you have it. There's your chuckles. We better get serious tonight. Let's look at the Bible. The book of John, St. John, chapter 10. Let me read a few verses here to kind of set our thoughts this evening. In John 10, verse 24, the Bible says, "Then came the Jews round about him," meaning Jesus, "and said unto him, How long dost thou make us to doubt? If thou be the Christ, tell us plainly. Jesus answered them, I told you, and ye believed not. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. But ye believe not, because ye are not of my sheep. As I said unto you, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father which gave them me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand." Oft times in the Bible we find the scripture referring to sheep, and that is in connection with human nature. Many characteristics among sheep are very, very evident in we human beings. One example of that is, sheep cannot be driven, they must be led. They know how to follow, and that's important. You know, we live in a world in which it's popular to follow someone or something. For example, you let a certain style of dress come along, next thing you know, everybody's dressing with that style. You let a certain hairstyle come into being, and next thing you know, everybody's sporting that particular hairstyle. Actions are also followed. We find a lot of kiddos in school sometimes will pick out somebody and follow them in their actions. And so it's just something in human nature that we tend to follow. In the scripture we just read just a moment ago, Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." I want to say tonight the most important person you can choose to pattern your life after is the Lord Jesus Christ. He said in John 13, verse number 15, "For I have given you an example that ye should do as I have done to you." Also in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 21, "Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps." My friend, the wisest decision anyone can ever make is to follow the Lord Jesus Christ. Following anyone or anything else leads to heartache and pain and trouble. If we're to effectively follow Christ, there are three very important things that we must do. And that's what I want to deal with for just the next few moments. If you're going to effectively follow the Lord Jesus Christ, first you must become a Christian through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. One must trust Christ to save him. And my friend, this faith involves several things. First of all, saving faith involves repentance. Luke 13, verse number 3, Jesus said, "I tell you nay, but except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish." Repentance is more than confessing and being sorry for sin. It's turning from sin, turning to God. The prodigal son is a good example. The prodigal son left the father's house, ended up in the pig pen. He came to his senses and he said to himself, I will arise and go to my father and say, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before thee. He not only said that, but the Bible says he arose and went to his father's house. That's repentance. He changed directions. And so repentance is necessary for saving faith, turning from sin to God. And then receiving is also experienced. In John 1, verse 12, the Bible says, But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. This scripture tells us of the human side of salvation. You see, one becomes a child of God simply through receiving Christ as his Savior. The object of our faith is not a book, it's not a creed, it's not a church, it's not a denomination. The object of our faith is a person, and that person is the Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not enough that Jesus came into this world through a supernatural birth, that he lived a supernatural life, that he died a supernatural death, and that he had a supernatural resurrection. That's not enough. There must be a receiving of God's gift. You see, a gift is not earned. It's just simply received. Whenever you have to work for it, it ceases to be a gift. And so the gift that God offers is his salvation through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And to enjoy that and to experience that salvation, all you have to do is simply receive it. And so saving faith involves repentance. It involves receiving. Also, regeneration is experienced. This is God's part in salvation. John 3, verse number 3, Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. You see, it's by regeneration that we're admitted into the kingdom of God. There's no other way. There's no other door. What does it mean to be regenerated? Well, simply it means to be born anew. It can be simply stated like this. When a man believes the claims of Jesus Christ and receives him to be all that he claims to be, that man is born again. A communist stood on a soapbox in a park one day and said, Follow the teachings of Marx and Lenin, and we promise a new coat on every man. A preacher then took his place on the soapbox, and here's what he said. Follow the teachings of Jesus Christ, be born again, and he will put a new man in every coat. This is what the world needs today. You see, the Apostle Paul said it very plainly in 2 Corinthians 5, verse number 17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. The world needs men who have become new creatures in Jesus Christ. I like what I heard, a quote from D.L. Moody here a while back. It said, Church doesn't just need a bunch of new members. It needs a bunch of old members made new, born again into the family of God. And so saving faith involves repentance. It involves receiving. It involves regeneration. But also saving faith involves rejoicing. When you know Jesus, when you put your faith in him, you experience true, real joy. In Acts chapter 8, we find the account of a man of God named Philip who witnessed to an Ethiopian eunuch, and that eunuch got saved. This eunuch had been to Jerusalem where he'd been to worship. He was riding back through the desert, reading the word of God. Spirit of God told Philip to join himself to that chariot. Philip did so, and he asked the eunuch, Do you understand what you're reading? He said, How can I except some man show me? At that, you know what Philip did? He preached unto him Jesus, the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Bible says in verse 39 of Acts 8, And when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip, that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. Now, what does it mean when he came up out of the water? Lord provided a place in the desert for that eunuch to be baptized. You see, he asked Philip, he said, What hinders me to be baptized? And Philip simply said, if you believe the Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, as your Savior, and put your faith in Him, you may. And God provided the water. The man was baptized. The Bible said he went on his way rejoicing. Brother Lester Roloff, a great preacher of the past, once said, rejoicing is lubrication for the soul. When a car begins to squeak, it's ready for a lube job. When a saved person begins to grumble and gripe and complain, he needs a lube job. He needs to begin to count his blessings and rejoice in his salvation. Then his grumbling and his griping and his complaining will soon disappear. I said it in a previous message, when you count your blessings and realize what God has done for you, it'll cause rejoicing in your soul and in your spirit. Paul said in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse number 16, rejoice evermore. And so, my friend, if you're going to successfully follow Jesus, as we need to do, first there must be faith in Him as your Savior. The second of the three things, you need to become a better Christian by fellowshipping with Christ. Fellowship with Christ should follow faith in Christ. In other words, there can be no fellowship with Christ until one has put his faith in Christ as personal Savior. If we're to effectively fellowship with Christ, there are some things that are necessary. There must be a time of devotion in our life, a time for prayer, a time for Bible study. You see, when we pray, we talk to God. When we read the Bible, God talks to us. It's a two-way communication that is so necessary. May I say, we need to stay in touch with God. We need to learn to spend time with God on a daily basis. You see, the Word of God is so important. It's the Word of God that has the power to bring conviction and cleansing and building up in our life. God's Word is our spiritual food, you might say. All of us eat something physically every single day of the week. We eat because we get hungry and we need that sustenance. We need that food. We need that nourishment to keep us going. The same is true spiritually. In the spiritual realm, we need the Word of God to feed us every single day that we might grow and develop spiritually like we need to. It's the Word of God that can bring to man peace and joy and hope and assurance. It's the Word that can protect from sin and from error. No wonder there's no solidness in Christianity today. We spend so little time talking to God and letting God talk to us. We've got a generation of spiritual midgets that need to grow in the Lord. And so, to fellowship with Him as we follow Him, there must be a time of devotion, but also there must be a time of dedication. You see, Romans 12, verse 1, the Apostle Paul said, present your bodies a living sacrifice. Present your body. That's action on our part. God will not take you or me and use us the way He wants to until we're willing to humble ourselves and submit ourselves and present ourselves to Him. We need to take the attitude of Isaiah the prophet in the Old Testament who said these words, here am I, send me. We should take that same attitude today. You see, we need to be dedicated wholly and completely unto the Savior. One can be separated from the world without being dedicated, but one cannot be dedicated without being separated. He needs to be our number one priority. He needs to be our number one person in our thought pattern. We should strive every single day, more than the day before, to please Him, our Savior. And then let me say, this fellowship with Him must be a daily thing. Jesus said in Luke 9, verse number 23, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. May I say tonight, you cannot get too close to God. None of us. The closer you get to God, the less space there is between you and Him for Satan to slip in. Get as close to God as you can on a daily basis. If fellowship with Christ does not become a daily affair and habit, I'm afraid we'll melt like chocolate soldiers when the devil and the world and the flesh close in on us. And that, by the way, is our three enemies as a child of God. The world, the flesh, and the devil. And they're out to get us. But thank God we can be victorious in Him. Also, fellowship with Christ can be delightful. I'm afraid many Christians go around looking like they just had a transfusion from a grapefruit. And some of them look like they've been vaccinated with pickle juice. God forgive us. Hey, God is good to us all the time. He's good to us when the cupboard is bare and when the cupboard is full. He's good to us when we have a job or when we don't have a job. Hey, He's good to us when the coronavirus is all around us, and He's good to us when it's not. God is good all the time. The psalmist says in Psalm 107, verses 8 and 9, "Oh, that men would praise the Lord for His goodness and for His wonderful works to the children of men. For He satisfieth," I like this, "He satisfieth the longing soul and filleth the hungry soul with goodness." Hear me well tonight. God is good to us. You say, "Well, I don't deserve His goodness." No, we don't. None of us do. But that's where His mercy comes in, and His grace, and His love, and His compassion for us. And so if you're going to successfully follow Jesus, you need to first of all become a Christian by faith in Christ, then become a better Christian by fellowshipping with Christ. And then thirdly and finally, we must produce fruit for Christ by showing others how to have what we've got, how to become a child of God. And if we're to bear fruit for Christ, we must first of all seek out the lost. My friend, we need to win souls for Jesus Christ. And if we're to do so, we must have certain convictions. We must be convicted that we're authorized by the Bible to represent Christ in this sin-sick world that we live in. Mark 16, verse 15, "And He said unto them, Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." We've got the greatest authority we could ever have, and that's the authority of the Word of God. When I think about that, I think about that little shepherd boy, David, facing that big old 9-foot-plus tall giant. That giant was making fun of David and said, "You've come to me without a spear, without a weapon." He said, "Am I a dog that you've come searching for me to get rid of me?" And with that, he laughed and said, "I'm not afraid of you." But I like what David said in response. He looked that giant square between the eyes and said these words, "I come to you in the name of the Lord God of Israel." That's all the authority you need. For you see, David took that stone and put it in his slingshot, swirled it around and let it go, and that stone went right between the eyes of Goliath, and he fell to the earth. David had the proper authority. We got that same authority tonight, the same Word of God. And my friend, we must be convicted that the goods we have to offer are second to none. Hey, Jesus is not just a way. He's the only way to heaven. You ought to be sold on that tonight if you're saved. You know, any salesman is a failure if he's not sold on his product. For instance, if you go to buy a vehicle and that salesman says, "Well, what do you want to see?" And you say, "I like that one over there." And he would say to you, "Well, you know what? That's a piece of junk. That thing doesn't run right. It burns oil. It burns gasoline just like water. Man, it won't get you anywhere. It's worthless. Are you going to buy it?" Of course not. That car salesman must lift up that vehicle to you, make it attractive to you, make it something you really want. And we as God's people in this old world we live in today need to go out into this world and make people want what we've got. Be a proper salesman of Jesus Christ. We must be convicted that this old world, which is doomed and damned, needs what we have to offer, and that need is Jesus. If these three things will grip our hearts, we will seek out the lost and will bear fruit for Him. If we're to bear fruit for Christ, we must go forth with sympathy and compassion. Our unconcern, our indifference, and our lukewarmness has dried our tears. Listen to me, we should see people not as simply a stick figure walking around. We should see people as a soul that's going to spend eternity in one of two places. You see, we would have sympathetic hearts if we would get a new vision of souls eternally separated from God. If we're to bear fruit for Christ, we must faithfully sow the seed. Romans 10:17, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. I've told you prior, and I'll say it again, I believe in the word of God, I love the word of God, I need the word of God, I intend to preach the word of God. It's not what Brother Mike says that makes the difference, it's what God says that makes all the difference. When we sow the word of God, we'll reap precious souls. There is not one thing you can take with you to glory except the precious souls that you've won to Christ. We should be a witness verbally when God presents the opportunity. We should be a witness with our daily living as people watch our walk. God help us tonight to follow Jesus. That is so important. I wanted to title this message tonight, How You Can Be Happy, because I believe that's the only way we can be happy, is to follow Jesus. Happiness comes as we follow Him. I challenge you tonight, if you never put your faith in Him as your Savior, that's first base. Trust Him tonight as your Savior. As a child of God tonight, if you've been slack, if you've set back when you should have gone, if you fail to be a witness when God's given you the opportunity, ask God to use you in the days to come. Be a shining light for Him. I promise you He will. Let's pray. Our Father, as we come before you tonight, we're so thankful for the Word of God. We're so thankful for the Savior that sets the example, that sets the path before us, and all we must do is simply follow. Help us to see the importance of following you in every step that we take. I pray tonight for that soul that cannot say for sure, I know if I died tonight, I'd go to heaven. That soul that might be listening right now, help them to realize that they can simply open their heart and receive you as their personal Savior and solidify their home in heaven. I pray for that child of God tonight that maybe is discouraged, that's maybe racked by fear, that maybe is not happy. Help them to realize tonight that if they'll just simply set their determination to follow you, life will have a whole new meaning for the better. Thank you for what you're going to do and what you've done. Bless your word tonight. In Christ's name we pray, and with thanksgiving, amen. As we say each time, if God's led you to make a decision through the word, I just pray that you'll take the time to drop us a line and let us know, because we want to be of help to you, want to pray for you. We thank God for you. Until next time, God bless you.